All right.
So we, so shoulder, elbow, wrist, and we are going to check the anatomy with MRI, X-ray, and ultrasound of the knee. So, very easy one, that's the patella there. So what is this structure, PCY2, who's here? Adi, Philip. So Adi, what is this here? Say it again. Medial contact, medial contact, very good. This is medial contact. Philip, what is that here? There, you cannot see the meniscus on play film. So what is this surface here? That's a medial tibial plateau, okay? So one important thing that I see, I notice frequently, is that you call medial joint space narrowing when there is no joint space narrowing. And why is that? The lateral tibial plateau usually is in profile with the X-ray, so you can see this one is not the case, but sometimes you see just one line. And the medial tibial plateau is like tilted, right? So when you compare and you say medial joint space narrow, because you compare this portion of the femoral contact with this portion of the tibial plateau, and that's not correct, okay? You understand what I mean? So be sure that there is true joint space narrowing. Compare this with this, okay? This with this, not this with this area here. All right? Good. So that's a medial tibial plateau. What is this, Ahmed, here? The white line? Is it open? Isis is when it is open, right? So how do you call it? Your wife wants to call you. The scar, that's it, a facial scar, okay? Very good. So, Adi. No.
I'm just making up.
Okay. Philip?
Interesting.
It's like some type of eminence.
Eminence. What eminence?
Inter.
Intercondylar eminence. Good. Very good. Fibular neck. Fibular head, and this one is the this tip here. This is for Ahmed. How do you call the tips in all the bones? You see it in the ulnar stylus. Fibular stylus, okay? Fibular stylus, very good. That's the lateral tibial plateau. How do you call this concavity here in the lateral femoral condyle? Anyone?
That's the lateral condylar groove for the popliteus.
Correct. So popliteus groove of popliteus sulcus. Okay. So there is a normal concavity there. Don't call it erosion. Okay, don't call it erosion. But be careful, because this is one of the most common areas for gout, and you will find erosion there, right? But this concavity is normal there. What is this line, white line here? Similar to this line, but in this area.
I don't remember that.
The lateral femoral condyle.
Very good.
Lateral femoral condyle. How do you call this space here?
Intercondylar notch.
Intercondylar notch. Very good. This is the medial epicondyle. Okay? Or medial epicondyle or adductor tubercle, because it's the attachment site of the adductor magnus. How do you call this structure here? Just this. That was the intercondylar eminence. Lateral intercondylar tubercle or spine. Okay? So these are the medial and lateral intercondylar spine. Okay? So be careful, because this is not the attachment of the ACL and PCL, okay? We will see this later. But they are usually avulsed when there is an avulsion of the ACL. How do you call this?
John?
Say it again?
Girdle's
tubercle. Girdle's tubercle. Very good. And what attaches there? Very good, iliotibial band, excellent. If there is a medial epicondyle, there is a lateral epicondyle. What is this? Three muscles? Hamstrings. Do you know the hamstrings? Can you speak out?
Semitendinosus and membranosus.
And? Biceps femoris. Okay? Very good. So those are the hamstrings. And these are the?
Osteonemis.
Very good. I think there I am pointing to the intercondylar eminence, the styloid, fibular head. How do you call this line here? What is the representation of this line there? Anyone? Intercondylar roof. Who said that? Dr. Wilson. How do you call the line that you project here that should be almost parallel to the ACL? Rachel, do you know? Blumenstadt line. Okay, so if you put a line there, it's the Blumenstadt line, and you want the ACL parallel to that line. All right? And it's the representation of the intercondylar rod. Very good. What is this? No. Posterior to the quadriceps. What? The bursa, yes. Suprapatellar bursa. Suprapatellar bursa, in this case, with fluid, okay? So any small amount of fluid will go up here. Don't look for effusion there, don't look for effusion here, don't look the frontal view. Any small amount of fluid will go here, in the suprapatellar recess. Suprapatellar recess, I think, is a better term than suprapatellar bursa. What is the tendon here, coming there? What is this structure here? The white line there. Now, this is the intercondylar notch, right? And how do you call this area there? That is anterior. Trochlea, femoral trochlea, very good. Floor, this is the floor of the femoral trochlea. Patellar tendon, very good. And how do you call this fat pad here? Coffa's fat pad. This here? Tibial tuberosity. Very good, tibial tuberosity. or you call this area in the tibia. So the, if there is an intercondylar eminence, there are two fossas, right? One posterior and one anterior. So this is the posterior intercondylar fossa. And it's the attachment site of the PCL. Good. I think here I'm pointing this white line there. That is the two parallel white lines here. Which one?
Lateral
tibial plateau, very good. And that one is the medial tibial plateau. That's the anterior intercondylar fossa, and this is the area of the ACL attachment, not the spine. It's anterior to the spine. This condyle, medial or lateral? How can you tell? Medial. How can you tell? It looks bigger and usually projects inferior to the lateral condyle. That's the lateral femoral condyle. That's a merchant view, sunrise view. What is this? Medial or lateral femoral condyle? Medial. Why? Because the patella does not go medial. It usually goes lateral, always goes lateral. So you have, you see how this is pointing to the lateral side or tilted to the lateral side? So if you are in the marginal view and you want to know which facet are you seeing here, check where the patella is pointing or where is the subluxated, or see that it's more displaced to the lateral. The patella always goes lateral. And you can also see there the femoral head. So what is this? What is this area here? Medial femoral condyle? Lateral femoral condyle? Intercondylar notch or intercondylar fossa? That's a femoral head. That's the lateral femoral condyle. Lateral medial patellar facet. How do you call this area? Trochlea, femoral trochlea. Okay? And it has also two facets, one medial and one lateral. All right. So I couldn't bring the ultrasound machine here today, but maybe we can, when we do ANCHOR, we can check also need. We divide all the sonographic technique of the extremities in anterior, posterior, lateral, and medial approaches. Here I am in anterior approach. You want to put a pillow behind the knee to get some flexion of the knee and to avoid anisotropy of the patellar tendon. In this view, you can check the patellar tendon, the quadriceps tendon. You can check the bursas and the retinaculum. So this is what you see here. This is the patellar tendon, sorry, quadriceps tendon going to the patella. The patellar tendon, you can see also the retinaculum. We will see these structures in other approaches. So for the patellar tendon, you put the probe inferior to the patella, as you can see there, and you will see the patella, patellar tendon, and tibial tuberosity. Patella, patellar tendon here, and tibial tuberosity. All right, so this is a Hoffa's fat pad, Hoffa's fat pad. If you have a prepatellar bursitis, you will see it here. Infrapatellar bursitis could be superficial or deep. All right, so this is, does this tendon have a tendon sheath, peritendon, or nothing? The patellar tendon. Will you see tenosynovitis of patellar tendon? is similar to the Achilles tendon, okay? So there is a peritendon. There is no tendon sheath here. Okay, so peritendon is a double layer of fibrous tissue. In the transverse view, but look at how well you see the vuidotus and the patellar tendon. Very well defined, right? Very well defined margins. In the transverse view, the patellar tendon is flat and it's a flat, broad, white tendon, okay? And you can see it here, patellar tendon on MRI, femoral trochlea there. You can see here the femoral trochlea. This is the articular cartilage. This is the cortex, And this is an excellent view to check for crystal deposition in the tendon, okay? You can see here the patellar tendon. And here is the position of the probe, 90 degrees from the longitudinal view. Right, can you see the fibular pattern of the tendon there? Yes? Quadriceps tendon. So now we move the probe and we place the probe superior to the patella. And you can see the quadriceps tendon coming there, attaching in the patella. This is what we see with ultrasound. This more ill-defined than the patellar tendon. Why? Because this tendon is formed by different muscles, right? So the margins are not well defined, but you can see the different fibers of the different components of the quadriceps tendon. So the more superficial component is formed by what muscle? Rectus femoris. The middle component? Vastus medialis and lateralis. And the deepest component is vastus intermedius. Right? So you can recognize the different components of the quadriceps tendons. Then again, we rotate the probe 90 degrees and you obtain a transverse view of the tendon. So this is the position that you have to do to check for joint diffusion. All right? If you want to inject something in the joint, you can place the probe there, and if you want to check for effusion, you have to place the probe there, going a little bit medial and a little bit lateral. With ultrasound, you can also see the patellofemoral ligaments. One is here. This is medial or lateral? What do you think? Lateral, because the patella is tilted to that side, right? And this is the medial patellar retinaculum or medial patellofemoral ligament. And you can see it here with ultrasound. All right, so we finished with the anterior approach and now we go to the lateral approach. In the lateral approach, we ask the patient to rotate to the contralateral side. We put the pillow in between the knees and you obtain a longitudinal view and then transverse view. And you will check the lateral collateral ligament, the bicep tendon, and the IT band. So the IT band is flat and goes to the tibia, and the biceps and LCL go to the fibular head. All these structures have bursas in between, and we call the bursas according to the adjacent structure. So this is the iliotibial band bursa, this is the biceps bursa, this is the LCL bursa, okay? Here you can see the position of the probe to check for the iliotibial band. This is the lateral femoral condyle, and you can see here the iliotibial band attaching to the Gerdes tubercle in the tibia. This is the lateral femoral, lateral epicondyle and lateral condyle, as you can see there. This is the joint space. This is the tibia here, tibia there. This is the IT band, and you can see here the IT band coming there. Okay, so this IT band may have a syndrome, that is the IT band syndrome, and it's due to friction of the band with the lateral femoral condyle. That is common seen in What type of sports? Runners and? And what you're going to see here in the IT band syndrome, you will see thickening of the IT band and fluid edges into the IT band. This is a magnified view of the attachment of the IT band. You see how well you see this with autism, and that is attaching there. All right, then we do transverse view, and you can see here the IT band that is flat. Wide, flat and wide IT band there going to the tibia. If you represent all these structures in a lateral knee, you can see that the IT band is anterior and goes to the tibia. The LCL and biceps go to the fibular head. Okay, and you can think that this is the head of a bird with the beak of the bird. And if you increase the flexion, the bird opens the beak. You can see these structures well with ultrasound. Here you can see the biceps muscle and biceps tendon attaching in the fibular head. You can see here the biceps attaching to the fibular head in this area with ultrasound. The LCL goes from posterior to anterior. So it's difficult to see the LCL in one single image. Okay, so you see a little bit of LCL here and a little bit of LCL there. All right? So when, in what pathologic condition can you see the LCL in one single slide? And what is your concern when you see that? Well, dislocation that probably you will not see it in one single slide. What condition has anterior translation of the tibia? ACL tear. Correct. So if you have if you see the LCL in one single image, suspect that the patient may have an ACL tear. Here you can see the fibular head, the tibia here. The tibia there, then the joint space, then the joint space with the meniscus, and then the popliteus groove or popliteus sulcus there, and the LCL goes all the way up and attaches superior to the sulcus, right? As you can see here. The IT band is flat and the LCL is round, okay? In the short axis view, it's round. Around ligament. So these are the lateral stabilizer structures of the knee. And this is the anatomy is very complex here. You have several structures, the LCL, the biceps, the popliteus tendon, and then you have a lot of small ligaments that are very difficult to see on MRI. In 2000, this was, you know, everywhere. Everybody was describing all the anatomy of the posterolateral complex. That is very important because if you have a posterolateral instability, what may happen to the patient after ACL or PCL reconstruction? Will fail. So they have to reconstruct the posterolateral corner, right? So they started describing all these things. Do you want to study this? Fibular, favellar ligament, okay, LCL, it's okay, bicep tendon, popliteal fibular ligament, popliteal meniscus ligament, arcuate ligament. This is a ligament that you cannot even see with MRI. You have to do a special technique and thin slices. So, thanks God, 2 weeks ago, they published this paper. MR predictors of posterolateral corner instability. And what was the conclusion? Check the LCL. That's the only important thing there, okay? So all the rest is just for publish and to get famous. Just check the LCL that is going to be the predictor of instability. All right? In the posterior approach, what we check? We check the popliteal fossa with the popliteal vessels. We check the bursas here. We check the semimembranosus, and we check the gastrocnemius. So I inverted the MRI to compare with the ultrasound. And you can see here the popliteal vessels here, popliteal vessels. You see here the medial head of the gastrocnemius. This tendon here is the semimembranosus, okay? Semimembranosus here. On top of the semimembranosus, you have the semitendinosus, all right? Then you have the gracilis here, and this is the sartorius, all right? So what are the tendons of the pes anserinus? Very good. Semitendinosus, sartorius, and gracilis. These three structures here will form the pes anserinus. Semimembranosus is not part of them. So this is a long axis view of the semimembranosus. This is a long axis view of the semitendinosus on ultrasound. And this is a short axis view of the semitendinosus with ultrasound. For the to evaluate the medial knee, we ask the patient to externally rotate the hip. And you can put the probe this way, and you will check the MCL, pes anserinus, and the associated bursas. So here you see these three tendons, Babna. What is this? Very good. And this one here, that does not go with the pes anserinus, big tendon, biggest tendon here. Let me go back. Is this tendon here? Semimembranosus. All right, so yesterday we had a case of a snapping knee syndrome in a patient with osteochondromas. And we found in one knee the semitendinosus was snapping on the osteochondroma. In the other knee, we couldn't find what tendon was producing the snapping. Then MCL. So this is from radiology too, and you can see they describe three layers in the MCL. The deep one that is formed by the meniscofemoral and meniscotibial ligament, that is the weakest one. Then you have the true tibiofemoral ligament or MCL, and then describe this superficial aponeurosis, that is the deep crural fascia. But again, what's the important thing here? This in the middle one, okay? Is the one that you can see there, is the one that you can see here, and is this one there, okay? So this thick one is the important one. Don't worry much about this and about this one, okay? This is the MCL on MRI. You can see it here, and pay attention, it comes all the way down here to the proximal tibial shaft. And you can see the same with ultrasound. This is the tibia, femur, meniscus here, and you can see the ligament coming there and attaching there. This is a magnified view of the MCL. Look at how well you can see the fibers of the MCL. You can stress this and check this with us. All right, so the ACL. The ACL has two components. One, anterolateral, and one posteromedial. Okay, so here you can see this one, the posterior component, is shorter and more vertical, and this one is the anterior. These two components gives the to the ligament a striated appearance. You can see here the ACL attaching anterior to the intercondylar eminence. Okay, it goes anterior to the anterior intercondylar fossa. Good. And this is the appearance of the ACL. You will not see a black, a completely black ACL. And you want this ligament to be parallel to the intercondylar roof. You can tolerate up to 15 degrees of angulation. When you have a tear, the ligament gets more horizontal. You can also check the ligaments in the coronal, and you can see here the ACL coming there, it's coming here, coming there, and this is the PCL. What is this ligament here?
Meniscofemoral
ligament, very good. So in 15% of the cases, you cannot see the ACL in one single slide, so you have to check the all the sagittal series to see the ACL. Good, PCL is thicker. There are also two components in the PCL, but in the case of the PCL, you don't see the two different components. You see just one thick ligament. All right, and attaches in the medial femoral condyle and in the posterior intercondylar fossa. And be careful with the PCL, because what may happen with the PCL in this area here? Magic angle, very good. You may have magic angle, okay? You may have magic angle there in the patellar tendon too. All right? So in what sequences can you see magic angle? Say again? Good. All the proton density too. All the short TE sequences, you may have magic angle. All right. So here you can see the attachment of the ACL and PCL in the posterior intercondylar and in the anterior intercondylar fossa. All right. So I think I will start talking about the meniscus here. So this is the medial or lateral meniscus? Medial meniscus, you can read it here. So medial meniscus has this C shape, and the lateral meniscus has this O shape. The lateral meniscus covers 70% of the surface of the lateral tibial plateau, and this one about 50%. And this meniscus, menisci are different. This has the same diameter all the way here, right? The same distance here. And this one is narrow anteriorly, and in the body too. The attachment, the posterior horn of the medial meniscus attaches in between the posterior horn of the lateral meniscus and the PCL. The anterior horn of the medial meniscus can attach to the tibia, or could be free attached to this ligament, that is the transverse ligament, or could be attached to the ACL. Okay, don't forget when you're checking for meniscal tears to check the meniscal roots. In this sagittal view, you can see that the posterior horn of the medial meniscus is taller than the anterior horn. And you can recognize that this is the medial meniscus because of the triangular shape of the medial tibial plateau. We are moving to the center of the knee, and you can see here the posterior horn, anterior horn, and of course this is the body of the meniscus. The lateral meniscus, you can recognize the lateral tibial plateau because it has a cane type shape, and you can see here the posterior horn and the anterior horn. And the posterior horn and anterior horn are similar in size, and this is not a minor detail, because if you see that the posterior horn of the lateral meniscus is smaller than the anterior horn, you have to suspect that there is a meniscal tear. There is meniscal distortion with a flap that is displaced. What is this structure here? What tendon? Anyone? popliteus tendon. Okay, and this is the popliteus hiatus here in the lateral meniscus, and you shouldn't confuse this with that there. This is the menisco popliteus ligament there, coming there. All right, so anterior horn, body, posterior horn. There is a tendon sheath here connected to the joint, so sometimes you have loose bodies that may go into the popliteus tendon sheath. This is the lateral meniscus. You can see here the popliteus, anterior horn, posterior horn, and popliteus tendon there. This here is the articular cartilage. The gray stuff here is the articular cartilage. This is an open magnet that this knee has more than 20 years ago. This knee. In this coronal proton density facet, you can see here the this is also an open magnet. This is a kind of a stair image. And you can see here the posterior horn of the medial meniscus, posterior horn of the lateral meniscus. You can see the popliteus tendon coming there, LCL. This white is the cartilage there. All right, so when we go anteriorly, you can see the body of the medial and lateral meniscus that is smaller than the anterior and posterior horn. This is the, what is this structure here? Anyone? But this is the popliteus tendon, very good. This is the LCL, this is the PCL, this is the biceps femoris, very good. And this is the semitendinosus, and this coming here is semimembranous. All right, here you can see the meniscus. To evaluate the meniscus, you want the short TE sequences because you improve visualization of tears. The shorter the TE, the better to see the tear. So you can do proton density or T1. Here you can see the meniscus there, and the meniscus. This is from radiology. This is a paper from Resnick, and you can see here, this is the hyaline cartilage. This is fibrocartilage, that is the meniscus, and the meniscus has this component that is the red zone. And if you have a tear in the red zone, the outcome is better because there is more blood supply there. Okay, so they may repair a tear here. They probably will not repair a tear here, depending on the age of the patient and many factors. Several times you see increasing an intensity in the meniscus, and this is probably anisotropy or sometimes a myxoid degeneration inside the tendon, depending on the age of the patient. And if you have a kid, kids may have more red zone, and you can see this increasing intensity in the meniscus. Okay, so don't call this a tear. John, what are the three MRI findings of meniscal tear? Articular surface, the femoral, the tibial surface, or give me 1 second. Or
distortion of the
femoral surface, tibial surface, or free margin, okay? So the meniscus has the femoral surface, tibial surface, capsular margin, or free margin. So the tear should go through the femoral surface, tibial surface, or free margin. It doesn't matter if the signal intensity goes there. So linear hyperintensity. Then what else?
Shape distortion.
Meniscal distortion. And the last one is? Meniscal flap. Okay, you see a fragment of the displaced fragment of the meniscus. Good. You have to know the different meniscal ligaments. You may have This is the most common one that we usually see, that is the transverse meniscal ligament that goes from the anterior horn to one meniscus to the anterior horn of the other meniscus. And in this case, we also have this that is called menisco-meniscal ligament, and you call it according to the anterior attachment. So this would be a medial menisco-meniscal ligament because it's attaching in the anterior horn of the medial meniscus. Okay? The importance of this, you can see there, you can see there, you can see there. The importance of this is that you shouldn't confuse this with what? Yes. What tear? What type of tear? What type of tear? John?
Flap.
Yes, how do you call it? When you have a flap?
Yeah.
Bucket handle tear. Yeah. You see the double PCL, and it could be a bucket handle tear. All right. So the other ligaments are the meniscofemoral ligaments that we saw, that are two, and we call them or Capri and Oyster. Very good. All right. Thank you very much. This is a small island. This is a small key. We went there to do some scuba diving. This is in Belize. Pretty cool, no? You have there a couple of tables and a grill pit, and that's it.
Where is that?
Yeah, Belize. Are you going? Take me.